Now we'll try to build the first amplifier using BJT. So let's try to build what is called the common emitter amplifier, okay, using NPN BJT. And I will not be going through how to do common emitter amplifier using PNP and all these things. It's done for the PMOS, so going through the same logic, you can always extend it for NPN and PNP and all these things. These counterparts are very similar, so let's do only one case, okay? So before that, let us see how we did the common source amplifier. For example, if you want to talk about common source amplifier, let's do without a feedback, so that we have some simplicity. So we had a VDD line, and we said that we'll use a drain bias resistor to bias my drain of the transistor. This is a drain, and this is the source, and this is a gate, and I have a resistor R1, a resistor R2 for biasing the gate. It's a voltage divider bias, and I grounded the source, right? It's a common source amplifier. And then I give signal here, and then I take the output here, and all these things, that is a different story, okay? So it's something that we know very well. It's not going to change for each amplifier. So RL, because this is the way you are supposed to give a load, and this is the way you are supposed to give the source, okay? So it has nothing to do with the amplifier design. You just connect it. This is a complete setup. You just use a connect capacitor and just attach it here. Use another capacitor, attach it here. That's it. This is the main body, okay, that you are trying to build, okay? Now, how would you extend it to the case of NPN BJT? So you have a BJT here, okay, going by the same logic. You see the small signal also is very much similar. If I assume beta tends to infinity, the small signal is also very much similar, okay? So, I mean the small signal model. So what do we do here? You have a line which is called the VCC line, which is the convention. Essentially, this is the drain terminal, so you attach the positive supply voltage to it, call it VDD. So you have a collector terminal at the top, so you have a positive voltage attached to it, you call it VCC. That's the only terminology change. So you have a collector bias resistor, so that this node is not going to ground when you connect the load. And then you have this collector terminal and this emitter terminal going to ground. Okay, so you have some IC flowing here, and some IE flowing here, and then you have some base current flowing here, okay? And you try to bias it, the base, with a voltage divider bias R1 and R2. Remember, it will not work if you don't bias the base, because I need a minimum of 0.7 volt at the base for it to work, okay? So if you don't bias it, it will not work. So this is how you will connect for it to bias without a feedback. But then we said that we could still build amplifier, common source amplifier, without any feedback, okay? But you should not build a common emitter amplifier without any feedback. This is simply not allowed, okay? So this configuration is something, this voltage divider bias without feedback, okay? So it's not allowed. This configuration is not allowed without feedback. So what do I mean by that? If you don't have feedback, then this node potential will be affected only by these two resistors. Okay, for a moment you assume that IB is zero. That's also still okay. Okay, so what is this voltage? If you assume IB is zero, it is VCC into R2 by R1 plus R2. Okay, so what happens? This voltage is going to be your VBE. Okay, and it is fixed. It's going to be fixed. Now, if suppose my collector current is given by, that it's IS into exponential of VBE by thermal voltage. Okay, and then I give my VBE. This VB is this expression, that is what I have said, okay? Now I said that this is a strong function of temperature and this is a strong function of temperature, okay? So given that my VB is fixed, if this IS and VTH is changing as a function of temperature, because when the transistor is going to operate and draw some current, there will be power dissipation, and that will affect my temperature, because silicon devices dissipate power in the form of temperature, and then that temperature is going to affect my IS and VTH. These two are strong functions of temperature. Okay, so if that affects these two parameters, then IC is going to be affected. And how IC will be affected, you know, as a function of VBE, my IC is like this. Okay, this is IC. Okay, and I know that, I'll say for example, I have fixed the VBE here. My IC is fixed at this point. Now, because of temperature, let's say the IC is shifting here. Because of temperature, temperature increases, IC will increase. In case of MOSFET, I said that with increase in temperature, our ID reduces because of mobility reduction. But this is diffusion current, and which has positive temperature coefficient. BJT has positive temperature coefficient. So it's very important. So your current is going to increase, and say for example, your current is now this point, is increased to this point, say. Okay, so from here to here, which is seeming like a small increase, the VBE should vary accordingly. Okay, but then you have said you have fixed the VBE, so your current increase would affect your, should affect your VBE, but it is not getting affected. So what happens, the current keeps on, and you are maintaining VBE at one point only. Okay, there is no way that your current will be maintained at some value, because current keeps on increasing with increase in temperature, and VBE is not being controlled at all. Okay, so what happened is that, see, essentially if current increases, if I want to bring it back to the same current, I should reduce the VBE value. Okay, somehow I should establish the feedback, but here because of no feedback, current will keep on increasing. Your VBE, it's fixed at some point, it doesn't make any sense at all. So eventually the current will increase to some value of infinity, or very high value. I am saying, ideally it can go on into infinity, but practically it's not possible. It will damage your device. Okay, with increase in temperature, your current keeps on increasing and the device will get damaged. So an important concept is never bias a BJT without feedback. Okay, or you need to have always bias BJT using constant current, or IC, or IE rather, feedback. Constant current feedback is very, very important. This is a very important concept. Okay, so you should never bias a BJT this way without a feedback. Although you could connect them in lab and see for you what happens, the transistor will get damaged. If you keep on increasing, the current, the temperature will increase and the transistor will get damaged. Okay, so with feedback, how does it look? So essentially, with feedback, you sense at the source and feed it back to the source. That's the first thing that we have done. So you sense at the source using a current I naught. Then you compare the current ID, these two should be same. So feedback is internal to the source, that is what we said. Similarly, if you want to establish a feedback here, you connect a current, you sense at the emitter and feed it back to the emitter, which is called emitter feedback. And this will establish a feedback internal to the emitter. And this is what we call it as common emitter amplifier with emitter feedback. Okay, so I'll redraw the circuit. Remember, I said don't do voltage divider biasing without a feedback. It's not that you should never do voltage divider biasing for a BJT. If you don't have a feedback and do a voltage divider biasing, then this VBE will be fixed, and then because of that current will not be, current will keep on increasing because VBE is anyway fixed. If temperatures are varying, current will basically vary because VBE has nothing to do with feedback. But then if you have a feedback, you can always bias your base using some voltage divider bias, because this potential will vary according to the current change of, if suppose IC changes compared to the reference current, this potential will change and it will establish a feedback. Okay, so let me redraw my common emitter amplifier. Let's common emitter amplifier with emitter feedback. If I want to draw this, okay, so let me do this. So I have the collector resistor, this is the VCC rail, okay, and I have the transistor here, the base, R1, R2, to establish the feedback, to establish the base bias, and to establish the feedback, I have a reference current I0, which is equal to the emitter current, okay. And collector current will be automatically defined by the relationship between emitter, base and collector current. This is IC and this is the source voltage, here is the emitter voltage and this is the collector and this is the base, okay. And for it to be an amplifier, you basically connect the load and the source. So source should be connected using a capacitor C1 like this, RS and VS. And load should be connected using a capacitor C2, RL, and you want this terminal to be incrementally grounded, exactly same thing what we did in the MOSFET. So you connect it to a capacitor to ground, that's it, okay. So this is C3, okay. This is the only thing that we will make, and then what is the analysis here, what we'll define all the quiescent points. The VBE here, essentially, so VB essentially is nothing but, because VE is emitter potential is not grounded, and I really cannot figure out the emitter potential just by looking at it because it is connected through a current source. So let me figure out what is my VB. Okay, VB is nothing but VCC times R2 divided by R1 plus R2. This is only VB if I have IB equal to 0, but if IB is non-zero, then I will have IB into R1 parallel R2. Okay, that is also occurring here. Okay, so it's very simple idea. If you don't see how it came, then I suppose that you know the idea of superposition. So superposition says that if you have two sources in a circuit, then you use one source at a time, calculate the voltage at one point, and add them. The response, the total response at that node voltage will be the individual responses due to individual sources, okay, and some of the individual responses due to individual sources. So I have VCC and IB. Say for example, I will represent this voltage divider here. So first case, let me put first case, I'll have R1 and R2 with VDD, okay, and this is grounded. So this is the only source I have, VDD is the only source I have, which will give me, this voltage will be VDD, or let's call it VB, equal to VDD into R2 by R1 plus R2, the first term I'll get. And the second case is where I will assume this source is not there and consider only the IB current, okay, because IB is also a source, IB is a current that is flowing in. So whatever current that comes here, part of it is IB and part of it is going through R2. So I cannot apply the voltage divider rule just like that without with considering IB. So first I ignored IB, now I'll consider IB and ignore VCC. So I'll get I'll have an IB current flowing in this direction, and let me ground it, and then I have R2 to ground, and R1 to VCC. Now it is again deactivated, meaning that is also shorted to ground. So I'll have R1 here. So I have IB flowing through R1 and R2, and IB is in this direction. So when I calculate this node voltage, it will be negative IB times R1 parallel R2 to be my total voltage VB. So I add these two. So I'll get VCC R2 by R1 plus R2 plus negative of, because current is flowing in this direction, this voltage developed VB will be negative IB times R1 parallel R2. So I have this value, okay. So this is my VB, and my VE will be, VBE minus VB, okay. Or rather it is VB minus VB, sorry, VB minus VBE. You know VB, you assume that VBE is approximately equal to 0.7. and you calculate VE. Okay, so this is how you will figure out the quotient points, and this is very simple. Once you know IC, you will calculate this particular voltage VC, and then IC you can figure out by the expression. You know this expression that you have, IC is equal to IS into exponential of VV by VTH. Okay, this expression can give you IC, but then see, it is, if you do, if you know IS and all these things, you can figure out this way, but then it's always approximate expression that you approximate estimate that you can have. If this is I naught, then emitter current is going to be I naught, and collector current plus base current is going to be your IB. Collector current and base current going to be your IE. Okay, so let me say IE is equal to IC plus IB, okay, which is equal to IC plus IC by beta, because IB is IC by beta. Okay, and then IE is nothing but your I naught, which is something that you know, okay, the reference current. So you can estimate IC very easily, because I naught is nothing but IC into 1 plus 1 by beta. Okay, so this is equal to, or this implies rather, okay, IC is equal to I naught multiplied by beta by beta plus 1. Okay, and this term beta by beta plus 1 is often called as alpha. Okay, so this term is often called as alpha, and you can find out what is beta in terms of alpha and other things. This is basically your current gain, again in common base configuration. This is a current gain in common base configuration, because you can treat this as your emitter current and this is collector current. So if I take collector as the output and emitter as the input, output by input, this becomes alpha. So current gain in common base configuration. These are just terminologies, okay? So you should be able to use the expressions at your hand and figure out what is the quotient operating point. That's why I did this exercise to you. Now coming back to the small signal, small signal gain of this particular common emitter amplifier with emitter feedback. Let me put down that again. Common emitter amplifier with emitter feedback. Common emitter amplifier with emitter feedback. If I want to put down the large signal model again, then I have my transistor and I sense at my emitter, and the feedback is to the emitter, which is internal, and let me call it I naught, which is equal to my IE in this direction, and I have the VCC rail, and this is RC to prevent this node going to incremental ground, and you have a capacitor C1 to connect to the load, and this is my IC in this direction, and I have IB in this direction, okay, and I have my voltage divider biasing R1 and R2 to bias the base, and I give my signal VS and RS through a capacitor C1, and this is C2, okay, and this node should be incrementally grounded, so I connect the capacitor C3, right? So this is all about my common emitter amplifier with emitter feedback. Now if IB is not equal to 0, okay, meaning if beta is not very large, okay, the small signal model, how do I draw it? It will look something like this. So I'll have the base part, and the transistor itself will have an RPi, and this is my VBE, and I'll have this to be GM VBE, and you know, let me assume that VA tending to infinity, so that I don't have my R0, just to simplify analysis. Okay, so this is my collector, this is my emitter, and this is my, sorry, this is my base, which is the input port, and this is my emitter, and through a capacitor C1 I give my source, okay, Vs and Rs, and at the input side I have R1 parallel R2, okay, which is in parallel with R pi, because this emitter is also grounded, okay, because incrementally emitter is grounded. Now this is GMVBE and this is VCE, and you connect the load through a capacitor C2, and on this node you have another another resistor RC2 ground, incremental ground. Okay, so this is the small signal picture that you have for a common emitter amplifier with emitter feedback. Okay, this is very similar to that of a MOSFET, and then we said we want to have a gain, we want to have is equal to minus GM RL. Okay, this is what we want to have a gain, and we saw in different conditions how to achieve this gain for a common source amplifier. This is the gain for a common source amplifier. Okay, and the same case for a common emitter amplifier also. Okay, this is what we want to achieve. But see, if I want to achieve, then first of all I want all the Vs to appear as VBE. Okay, so I want this to be very very large, I want this R pi to be very large, I want this R1 parallel R2 to be very large. Okay, let's say that, you know, R pi is there. Now R1 parallel R2, you said that you make R1 parallel R2 much much larger than RS in MOSFET. Okay, we said this. Here if you do so, what will happen? So we know that this VB is equal to you know, we saw in the last class in detail that VB is nothing but your VCC into R2 divided by R1 plus R2, okay, minus IB into R1 parallel R2. This is what we said. Okay, now if I make R1 and R2 very very large, okay, this factor will not matter at all, because this is just a ratio, they will cancel out, they will give you whatever you have designed it for. So the large values will cancel out, because if you make it either in kilo, here also kilo, they will cancel out, mega, mega, they will cancel out, so it doesn't matter. But this one, as far as this one is concerned, if you make R1 parallel R2 very large, okay, so this factor that is multiplied with IB is going to be large. This increases if R1 parallel R2 increases. So what if it increases? If it increases, my VB will be a strong function of IB then, because IB is very small, I know that, but then if I increase R1 parallel R2, this VB will come down. Okay, I cannot precisely control this VB. In other words, for a fixed VCC, okay, I want R1 and R2 to control my VB to a maximum extent. Okay, if I keep increasing R1 parallel R2, then my IB will play a role, and that IB will be a function of bias, temperature and all these things, then that will start controlling my VB, which I don't want. Okay, so for to a large extent I want only my resistors to control my VB value, so that I will make sure my R1 and R2 is not very large in such a extent that this, when multiplied with IB, will create a major, you know, change to this particular factor. Okay, I should make sure that this factor, you know, should not make a major change to this factor, and I should choose R1 and R2 in that range. Okay, so choose R1 and R2 in such a way that when multiplied with IB, they are 1/10 of this value, so that it won't make, you know any change to this number. So choose R1 and R2 in that range, so that it is at most 110 to this value. Okay, so it's better to choose R1 R2 less than that value. Okay, so that is how we choose. So you cannot make R1 and R2 very very large, so this is limited in BJT. You have this limitation of increasing R1 and R2 in BJT, so you have to live with that. You will get some kind of reduction in the gain, but then you don't have a choice, because first of all you have to bias it properly for it to work the way you intend it to. So for that you should first compromise on certain things, and you have to live with that. You don't have a choice. Okay, so this is the case. But then if we say that beta is very very large, okay, IB is very close to zero, so no matter how much you increase this will not make a huge impact on this one. In that case you can have a large value of R1 parallel R2, and this RPI also is naturally larger, and these two will be very very small compared to that of these two will be very large compared to your RS. So VS will appear as VBE itself, and you will get your gain as minus GMRL when RC is also very large. Okay, so this is something that you can achieve. Otherwise the gain will be limited. For example, in this case, let me do the derivation for once. Okay, in this case my VBE is equal to VS into and under this is under an assumption, this derivation is under an assumption that you have found out the capacitance constraint for it to be short, and you know how to do it. You look into this side, on the right of the capacitor, and see what is the equivalent resistance, and in this case it is going to be R1 parallel R2 parallel RPI. Okay, and here if you want to look into the left of the capacitor, see what is R out, and then find the resistance occurring across it. So this combination plus RS will be the resistance occurring across it. It's the same logic as we did in MOSFET. Okay, you go by that and to find the capacitance constraint and treat it as short, and once you have done it, then you do the derivation what we are doing here. And see, remember, I am not going through in detail because we have done this in detail in common source amplifier. Okay, so it's just a waste of time if you do it again and again. We have a lot more concepts to deal with. Okay, so here VBE is equal to VS into R1 parallel R2 parallel RPI divided by R1 parallel R2 parallel RPI plus RS. Okay, this is going to be your VBE, and then your V out is equal to minus GM VBE times RL parallel RD. Okay, so you substitute your VBE in this expression and find out V out by VS, and then you make all the constraints that we have discussed, and you will get a gain approximately equal to minus GM RL. Okay, so this is something that you can verify it for yourself. And this is all about the common emitter amplifier with emitter feedback, and that leaves us with the discussion on common emitter amplifier with drain feedback. In this case it's a common emitter amplifier with emitter feedback is what we have discussed now. So in the next class we'll discuss something called common emitter amplifier with collector feedback, just like you had common source amplifier with drain feedback. Okay, so let me quickly rush to that also here only. So common emitter amplifier with collector feedback. Okay, so it's very straightforward. So you know that you have a BJT, NPN BJT in this way. This is the emitter, this is a collector, it's a base. And if you want to give collector feedback, you have to sense the current at the collector, because you will sense the collector, current at the collector and feed it back to the base, right? So sense it at the collector, this is VCC, and you feed it back to the base. Okay, and the bias is established, emitter is obviously grounded, and then you connect a capacitor to RL and connect another capacitor. This is C2, this is C1, and RS and VS. Okay, so it's very straightforward, just like a MOSFET, and you call it I0. Okay, and I0 is equal to IC in this case. Very very straightforward thing. Okay, now I'm not going to do small signal analysis because you know how to do it. You can assume beta tends to infinity and do the small signal analysis. You will get the same gain as you got in that of common source amplifier with drain feedback. Okay, so now touching on one important point, which is the current mirror that we had for a common source amplifier. Here also we can have a current mirror. So let me also discuss that current mirror, okay, or in other words BJT current mirror. Then let me put my transistor this way, and this is my emitter, collector, base, and collector base feedback. When I have proper current source established here, I not, and then if I make sure that I have another transistor, let's call it Q1, let's call it Q2. If I have another transistor with the same same VBE, this VBE is the same, emitter also same, say grounded, then I can make sure as long as this potential is greater than some VCE sat, then whatever that flows here will be the mirror of this collector current. Okay, so but what is this current? Will it be exactly same as I naught? It's a question. Okay, if base current is zero, if this is equal to I naught, if IB equal to zero for Q1 and Q2, okay, but if beta is not large, okay, and if IB is zero means beta tends to infinity, right? But if beta is not large, okay, then what happens? You have some IB here and some IB here. This is IB and this is also IB. That means you should have two IB flowing here. That means at this particular node, if I try to calculate the KCL, I have my collector current in this direction, and this is the I naught current, and whatever terminal current that flows in this direction, that is the collector current, right? So my I naught is equal to collector current collector current plus 2 times base current. Okay, and this current is something that I want to estimate. This will be equal to collector current, but what is collector current is something I want to estimate. This I naught is equal to collector current of this transistor if beta is not large, right? So what is this IC is something I have to estimate. If beta is large, then IB is 0, so 2IB is 0, I naught equal to IC, so here also IC equal to I naught. But then if it's not equal to if IB is not 0, then my IC can be easily found out, which is IC plus 2 times IC by beta is equal to IC into 1 plus 2 by beta, which implies my IC is equal to I naught divided by 1 plus 2 by beta. Okay, so if you want, if suppose someone told you that you have certain beta and IB is not 0, so you make sure you are feeding in some current. If you want certain IC, you feed in some current I naught in such a way that my IC is equal to I naught by 1 plus 2 by beta. Okay, so this current I naught will be mirrored accordingly. Okay, so and in case of MOSFETs, we found that if suppose you scale the W by L, say for example, let me draw the MOSFET current mirror here. So if I make sure to keep all of them in the same potential and VG of all are same, then whatever reference current I put in here, if suppose this is I naught, then this will be I naught. If this is W by L and this is W by L, but if this is 2 W by L, which is scaling, then I said that this is I naught times 2. Okay, twice I naught is something I'll get here, as long as these VDS of these transistors are kept in saturation condition. Okay, now as far as a bipolar transistor is concerned, if you try to keep you know, if you try to add one more transistor and then try to scale the current, it is not as straightforward as that of a MOSFET, because the current expression does not have linear dependence on you know, your width or the length of the transistors. Okay, so it's not that straightforward to use another bipolar transistor in different width or length and then scale the current, because the width and length terminologies for a bipolar transistor itself is very much different to that of MOSFET, and the way the bipolar transistor works is a little bit more complicated and involved than that of a MOSFET. So as far as MOSFET is concerned, you only mirror the currents, you don't scale the currents. Okay, so this is all about the common emitter amplifier with collector feedback, and then you know this is about the current mirror. And if you want to bias you know, the transistor using a current mirror, you bias it this way so that you ensure this current is I0 or IC rather, you know, given by this particular expression, and then you connect a capacitor and give the source here RS and VS, and you know put a resistor here and then connect another capacitor and a load here, and to make sure that it works as an this transistor works as an amplifier. Okay, that is also possible. This is like making an amplifier using current mirror bias. So we have discussed all kinds of bias as we did it for an NMOS and PMOS for a BJT, NPN BJT. I give it as an exercise to you to go back and work it out for a PNP transistors and see if you can convert the transistor circuit that we have done so far for an NPN to PNP. Okay, so this summarizes our discussions on constant current bias for different types of transistors, particularly to implement a common source amplifier. In the next few lectures, we'll discuss about what is called the control sources. It will be very interesting, and we'll realize different kinds of amplifiers like common gate amplifier, common drain amplifier, which will be analogous to common base and common collector amplifiers. Okay, we'll discuss everything involving MOSFETs, and you can always extrapolate it to BJTs. Okay,